Morning. Today we start on the subject of quantum stars. I'm sure all of you know the star Sirius, the brightest star in the sky. It was suspected for quite some time, from the time of the great astronomer and mathematician Bessel, that Sirius had a companion star. But the companion itself was detected only after decent telescopes came on the scene. Our story begins with the American astronomer Walter Adams measuring the temperature and the radius of the companion of Sirius. Now, what he found was the temperature of Sirius is more or less the same as the temperature of the companion, but the radius of the companion of Sirius was only the radius of the Earth, whereas the radius of Sirius was comparable to the radius of the Sun, which is 1,000,000 kilometers. So if you have a star of the mass of the Sun, but a radius of mere 10,000 kilometers, then its average density will not be 1.4 grams per cubic centimeter, like in the case of the Sun, but it'll be 1,000,000 grams per cubic centimeter. And this upset Eddington enormously. He had just completed, if you remember, his spectacularly successful theory of the stars. He screamed from the rooftop, "A star will need energy to cool." So let's try to understand what he meant by that. We saw last time, or last week, the stars are gaseous blobs held together by their mutual gravity. The inward pull of gravity is balanced by the combined pressure of gas and radiation. So let me read for you what Eddington said. "I do not see how a star which has once got into this compressed condition is ever going to get out of it. Their high density is only possible because of the smashing of the atoms, which in turn depends upon the high temperature. It does not seem permissible to suppose that the matter can remain in this compressed state if the temperature falls. When the supply of subatomic energy fails and there is nothing to maintain in the high temperature, then on cooling down, the material will return to the normal density of terrestrial solids. A star must therefore expand, and in order to regain a density thousandfold less, the radius must expand tenfold. Energy would be required in order to force out the material against gravity. Where is this energy to come from? The white dwarf can scarcely be supposed to have had sufficient foresight to make special provision for this remote demand. Thus, a star may be in an awkward predicament. It will be heat continuously, but it will not have enough energy to cool down." Extraordinary, right? The star is radiating and radiating and radiating, but it is not cooling down. And Eddington says, in order to cool down, the star must have energy. Again, we are back to our negative specific heat discussion. So what did Eddington actually mean? What he meant was, what will happen to the companion of Sirius when the nuclear reactor at its center fails? Since there is no further energy generation, the pressure supporting against gravity will decrease and the star will collapse. Will the star collapse to a singularity? This was Eddington's dilemma in 1925, stated in more understandable language than the way Eddington described it. Sir Ralph Herbert Fowler was a colleague of Eddington in Cambridge University. He was a professor of theoretical physics. One of his students was Adrian Dirac. In August 1926, Dirac came to Fowler with his paper on the new statistics, which had also been independently discovered by Enrico Fermi in Rome. And Fowler's job was to read it, approve it, and forward it to a suitable journal for publication, which he did. Within 2 months, by November 1926, Fowler had applied the new idea of Dirac to save the companion of Sirius. It is remarkable that this first application of the new rules of quantum physics was to explain the stability of a star and not to explain atoms and molecules, because it was only a few months later that Arnold Sommerfeld applied the Fermi-Dirac statistic to free electrons in metals, and his student Wolfgang Pauli applied it to explain the paramagnetism of metals. So it is an extraordinary thing that the first application of the newly discovered quantum rule was to explain the stability of an object as big as a star itself. I thought you'll be rather amused to know about that. Now, what did Fowler actually say? As the star collapses and its density increases, at some stage, the rules of quantum mechanics will take over from classical physics. At high densities, a new pressure arises due to the combined effect of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and Pauli's exclusion principle. Now, this quantum pressure, which is called the degeneracy pressure in literature, will stop the collapse at some radius or the other, just as the pressure due to Boyle's law stopped the collapse of the sun at some radius or the other. And what we will have is a quantum star. So let's try to explore this a little more. This is all old story now, but not when Fowler said this in 1926. So to place it in historical context, I would like to, with your permission, go back to that epoch and let's try to understand this spectacular conjecture by Fowler in the context of the physics of that moment. De Broglie had just said that particles are waves, with wavelength given by Planck's constant divided by the momentum of the particle. We knew from Schrödinger's equation that each state of a particle represents a system of standing waves, fundamental and its harmonics. And these waves obey the Schrödinger equation. Now, if you solve the Schrödinger equation for an electron in a box, one-dimensional box of length L, you will find that the energy levels are quantized, and the energy of the nth level is given by n squared h squared divided by 8ml squared. The first thing to notice is that unlike in the hydrogen atom problem, where the energy is inversely proportional to the square of the quantum number, the energy is directly proportional to the square of the quantum number and inversely proportional to the square of the size of the box. In this case, for simplicity, I have considered a one-dimensional box. Now, let us also recall what Heisenberg said around the same time. One cannot measure both the position and momentum of a particle with infinite precision. You are allowed to measure one of the two very accurately, but at the expense of an error in the measurement of the error of the other quantity. And if delta P and delta X are the errors in the measurement of the position and momentum of a particle, then of course you have this familiar Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. All right. And that's just a repetition from the previous slide. Therefore, if we try to confine a particle to smaller and smaller volume, you can do so only by virtue of giving it larger and larger momentum. Now, this motion of the particle, which is dictated to you by Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, has nothing whatsoever to do with heat. This is zero-point motion. Right? This is all familiar. You've all studied it 5-6 years ago, but please remember this scenario was just emerging in November 1926 when Fowler made this spectacular conjecture explaining the stability of the stars. Now please also remember that the expression for the energy level had 1 over L squared. Therefore, if I squeeze the dimension of the box, the energy levels will increase. This is almost similar to if I pluck a string which is that long, it'll produce low frequencies, but if I pinch the string here and pluck it, it'll produce higher frequencies. So it is the same thing, the fundamental and the harmonic change. So quantum mechanics is just wave mechanics. All right. So what Fowler said, or didn't say it in this language, but I'm saying it in this language because this is the language that's familiar to you. Let us consider the energy levels of an electron in a box, n electron in a volume V at a temperature of absolute zero, because I want to bring out the essential physical content of quantum theory, and therefore let's not confuse it with heat energy that may also be present. Let us insist we discuss it at T equal to zero. At T equal to zero, of course, in classical physics, the energy of all the particles is zero. The total energy is zero, the pressure is zero, and so on. Here it is not the case. Pauli's exclusion principle allows you to put two particles in each energy level, provided you are careful enough to put them with different spin orientations. But this is the lowest energy configuration that you can manage. I go on putting two electrons in each energy level till I run out of particles. If I give you 17 more particles, you will put in two electrons in 8 more levels, and the last one will be in the 9th level. Therefore, the highest energy level up to which all states are occupied and above which all states are empty depends upon the number of particles per unit volume. Now, you are not allowed to do this because this would violate Pauli's exclusion principle. Therefore, the ground state of an electron gas at absolute zero of temperature is the sum of the energies of all these electrons, and that could be an enormous amount of energy depending on the number of electrons per unit volume. Energy per unit volume is pressure. Remember, that's how we derived Boyle's law. Therefore, an electron gas has an enormous amount of pressure even at the absolute zero of temperature, and this pressure has nothing whatsoever to do with heat. It arises from the combined effect of motion due to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and Pauli's principle, which tells you you can put at most two particles in each quantum state. Therefore, if we were to paraphrase what Fowler said in 1926, an electron gas has an energy even at absolute zero, and the zero point energy will become large as the density of the electron gas increases. Once the quantum mechanical pressure of the electron stops the collapse, which it will at some radius or the other, the star would have found its ultimate peace. Because nothing can happen to it. Eddington can sleep peacefully. Nothing can happen to it even if its atomic reactor fails at the center. Why? Because this energy that has stopped gravity is zero point motion. The energy of the electron gas at absolute zero is similar to the energy of the electron in the n equal to one level of the hydrogen atom. Although the electron in n equal to one level has an enormous amount of energy, 13.6 electron volts, it cannot spend it because there is no energy level below that. Right? Therefore, as Fowler said in his November 1926 paper, electrons in a white dwarf are like a gigantic molecule in its ground state. You can no more expend that energy than you can expend the energy of an atom or a molecule in its ground state. Therefore, the companion of Sirius will find its ultimate graveyard as a star, which is a quantum star. Okay. So this is what Fowler said, not in this language, but paraphrased in modern language. Now, we go from Cambridge, we come to Madras. Chandrasekhar was a second year BSc student in Presidency College. And 1928 was a momentous year. His uncle C.V. Raman had discovered the, Raman and Krishnan had discovered the famous Raman effect in February of 1928. So during summer holidays, Chandrasekhar went to Calcutta to mingle with Krishnan and various other people. Youngsters were hanging around in Raman's group. And there he learned that the great physicist Sommerfeld was coming to Calcutta from Japan to personally see Raman effect with his own eyes. And after that, Sommerfeld came to Madras to give a lecture in Presidency College and also to do some sightseeing. Now, young Chandrasekhar, barely 18 years old at the time, had the audacity to find out which hotel Sommerfeld was staying in Madras and went and met him there. And there, Sommerfeld asked him, "What have you studied?" "Sir, I've studied your book on atomic physics." "No, no, no, that's all old stuff. It's all changed now. What else have you studied?" "I've studied statistical mechanics from Tolman's book." "No, no, no, it's all changed now. There is a new statistics." Of course, there are no books. Nobody, I mean, he's a young student, BSc student in Presidency College in Madras. So Sommerfeld reaches out to his briefcase and gives him a proof, galley proof, of his paper in German, applying the Fermi Dirac statistic to electrons in metals. And of course, all students of physics those days knew German, even in India, because most of the important papers were written in German. And therefore, Chandrasekhar knew German perfectly well at that age. So he went and studied Sommerfeld's paper, and that is how he learned about the great discoveries being made in Europe by Schrödinger, Dirac, Fermi, Pauli, and other people. And then, in the university library, he came upon Fowler's paper of December 1926. And then he said to himself, "This looks like a wonderful idea. Why don't I use it to derive a theory of quantum stars, like Eddington derived a theory of classical stars?" How did Eddington work on the theory of gaseous stars? Eddington said a star like the sun is stable because the inward pull of gravity is precisely balanced by the combined pressure of gas and radiation. Let's recall the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. dP by dr is equal to minus gm rho over r squared, where the pressure is the sum of gas pressure and radiation pressure. And as I emphasized several times, the pressure is to be calculated according to the ideal gas law or Boyle's law, and radiation, of course, is given by Stefan's law. So now what Chandrasekhar said is, let me construct quantum stars in which the inward pull of gravity is now balanced by the outward pressure of the electrons at absolute zero of temperature, and there is no radiation. Okay? So what you need then is an expression for the pressure of the electron gas. And today what you do is to go to the nearest book on statistical physics, and it's all Kittel's book on solid-state physics or Landau and Lipschitz. It's all there. But in 1928, these were not in textbooks. So Chandrasekhar had to derive all these things. So some of you would have already studied this. Those of you who are in MSc, others would not. But it never hurts to review things. So let me quickly recall for you how one would calculate the pressure of an electron gas at absolute zero of temperature. The first thing to appreciate is the change that comes about due to the new rules of quantum physics to statistical physics. In statistical physics, we talk of phase space, x, y, and z, three dimensions, and the other three dimensions are px, py, and pz, the three momentum components. In classical physics, all momentum values are allowed. This is not so in quantum physics. Consider the motion in one dimension, and let the electron be confined to a length L, our one-dimensional box. Classically, all values of momenta are allowed. There is absolutely no restriction. But in quantum physics, you know that because I have confined the electron to a length L, I know delta X is L. It's somewhere inside that box. Therefore, there is necessarily an uncertainty in momentum, which is given by Planck's constant divided by the length of the box. Smaller the L, larger the uncertainty in momentum. Therefore, not all these momentum values are allowed. It is meaningless to say that is an allowed momentum, because you can't even say that. That somewhere inside that is an allowed momentum. Therefore, you see, momentum space becomes discrete. This is the same thing. Energy levels and momentum are discrete in quantum mechanics. Here I'm making an explicit connection with uncertainty principle for reason that you will see immediately. Therefore, this phase space is not a continuous space with all momentum values allowed. Phase space is made up of little Lego blocks that children play with. The size of each Lego block is L into L into L. And the size of L is given by Planck's constant divided by the length of the box in each dimension. Therefore, the volume of each Lego block is h by L to the power 3, or h cubed by the volume. Okay? Therefore, phase space has to be built up from the origin with these little Lego blocks. This is the fundamental difference between classical statistical mechanics and quantum statistical mechanics, one of the differences, and that's what we'll be concerned with today. Therefore, that continuous sphere of classical physics is really made up of discrete blocks. And you'll say, how can I make a sphere out of a cube? It's very easy, first of all, to appreciate that the size of each cube is very small. It's Planck's constant divided by length. And if you're talking of macroscopic volumes, the size of the Lego blocks is very small. Therefore, for large enough systems, this will approximate a sphere to an arbitrary degree of accuracy. Now, at absolute zero of temperature, going back to what Fowler said, all momentum values up to a certain maximum value are occupied, and all momentum values above that are empty. What is the volume of phase space, momentum space, that is fully occupied? That is just 4 pi by 3 cube of this maximum momentum, which is called the Fermi momentum. Okay? Now, this is a reserved train compartment, but in each seat, two people are allowed to sit, provided you are careful enough to make the spin orientations point in the opposite direction. Therefore, let us calculate this Fermi momentum. How do we calculate the Fermi momentum? I give you n electrons in a box of volume V, and the temperature is zero. Therefore, I know all the states inside this are occupied, and all the states outside this are unoccupied. Now, how many Lego blocks are there inside that sphere? The volume of the sphere is 4 pi by 3 p of cubed. The volume of each Lego block is h cubed by the volume v. Therefore, this is the number of cells in phase space. What is the number of particles inside the sphere? That is simply the number of cells inside this sphere multiplied by 2, because I'm putting 2 electrons in each cell. Therefore, this formula tells me what the Fermi momentum is. If I give you n particle in a volume V, then the Fermi momentum is just the solution of this equation. And that's what I have written here, that the Fermi momentum is 3 over 8 pi to the power 1 by 3, Planck's constant, the number density of particles n by v to the power 1 by 3. Please notice that the mass of the particle does not enter this formula, because this discreteness came about due to uncertainty principle, and that doesn't care whether you're dealing with electrons or neutrons or protons, okay? This will be very important for us when we discuss the theory, Chandrasekhar's theory of white dwarfs. So here is a summary of what I have said. If I compress this box to increase the density or increase the number of particles, keeping the volume the same, the Fermi sphere that is occupied will increase because the Fermi momentum is proportional to density to the power 1/3. So as I increase the density, the Fermi momentum will increase as the 1/3 power of the density. Okay? I learned all these things more than 55 years ago. I remember this, so you should be able to remember if somebody wakes you up in the middle of the night. The Fermi momentum depends on density to the power 1/3. And the Fermi energy in Newton's mechanics is just the square of the momentum divided by the twice the mass of the particle. Therefore, the Fermi energy is proportional to density to the power 2/3. Please notice that this expression is valid only in Newton's mechanics because we have used E is equal to P squared over 2m. Secondly, notice that the Fermi energy explicitly has the mass of the particle, and the mass of the particle comes in the denominator. Therefore, given the same number of electrons and protons in a box, the Fermi energy of the protons will be 2,000 times less because the mass of the proton is 2,000 times more. Okay? So here is a grand summary. As I compress my volume, the Fermi sphere will increase. The radius of the Fermi sphere will increase as density to the power 1/3. The Fermi energy, which is the maximum energy up to which all states are occupied and all states are empty at absolute zero, increases as density to the power 2/3. Okay? So now we want to calculate the pressure of this electron gas. Let us recall how we calculated the pressure of an ideal gas. I did that for you in the second lecture. According to thermodynamics, the pressure of a gas of particles with finite mass is 2/3 the internal energy per unit volume. The internal energy is the number of particles multiplied by the average energy of the particle, which is n into 3/2 kT, and that gives me Boyle's law. P is equal to nkT. And please note that this pressure vanishes at the absolute zero of temperature. Now let's follow this same prescription and calculate the pressure of an electron gas at the absolute zero of temperature. The pressure is 2/3 energy density. The internal energy is the number of particles multiplied by the average energy of the particle. The particles have energy between 0 and EF. So the average energy must be somewhere in between 0 and EF. It may be 1/2 EF, 2/3 EF, 3/5 EF, but it is of the order of EF. So I put a bracket here and dot, dot, dot. You can work it out. Average energy is 3/5 times the Fermi energy, okay? But that doesn't matter. We are only interested in the scaling law. The average energy is proportional to the Fermi energy. Therefore, the internal energy is proportional to n into n by v to the power 2/3. Therefore, if I divide the left-hand side and right-hand side by the volume, it becomes n by v to the power 5/3. Therefore, the pressure of an electron gas at the absolute zero of temperature, assuming Newton's mechanics, is that the pressure is proportional to density to the power 5/3. Okay? Please work out all these constants next to the proportionality constant. Now, this pressure is known as the degeneracy pressure in the literature. So Chandrasekhar, for the first time, as far as I know, was the person who did all these things in 1928. So Chandrasekhar's theory of white dwarf is, he said, let me start like Eddington did with the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, but this time I will use the pressure of the electron gas And there is no radiation pressure because I'm at the absolute zero of temperature. So I have to solve this equation. Now this equation is easier to solve than Eddington's equation, because in Eddington's theory, the pressure was a function of both density and temperature. Here the pressure is a function of only density, so the problem is even simpler than Eddington's problem. And Chandrasekhar knew how to solve this problem. And when he did, what he found was the following mass-radius relation. The radius of such a star will be inversely proportional to the cube of the mass. And the constant of proportionality is given here in all its glory. So, if you go to the market to buy vegetables, 1 kilogram weight is that big. A 2 kilogram weight is that big. If you go to a shop to buy rice, a 10 kilogram weight is that big. In other words, the radius of an object increases as the mass of the object increases. So the first thing to notice is that a degenerate self-gravitating body, the relation between radius and mass is inverse. That the radius is inversely proportional to the cube root of the mass. Therefore, larger the mass, smaller the body. Okay? Now, you're not convinced. Some of you are not convinced by this. I can tell from the, I've been a teacher long enough that I can tell from your faces. So let's work this out, shall we? And please help me because of this viewing angle. So I'm only interested in scaling laws. And so I'm going to put myself before Newton and write dp by dr as p over r. So the left-hand side is the pressure divided by the radius, the pressure at the center minus the pressure at the surface, and the distance, that is just this. That is of the order of, we are not interested, g and so on, m. What is rho? M by r cubed. And what is in the denominator? R squared. Okay? What is pressure? Pressure is density to the power 5 by 3. Okay? Now please help. So this is of the order of A to the power 5 by 3 divided by R to the power 5. No. This side. P by R, okay, rho, dP by dr. I have to put one, so this becomes R to the power 6. Okay, all right. So please help me with this. This will give me R is proportional to 1 over m to the power 1 by 3, isn't it? So if only Chandrasekhar hadn't come around before us by 100 years, we would have done this, wouldn't we? So it's not all that difficult, but then we, of course, wouldn't have been able to give you these constants sitting in front unless you honestly integrated the differential equation. Suppose the radius of the star is inversely proportional to the mass. He also calculated that the average density is proportional to the square of the mass. This, you know, the mass-radius relation, therefore the average density is mass divided by the volume is m proportional to m squared, and the central density is 6 times the average density. These are exact results from his theory, okay? Now, so first thing Chandrasekhar did was, he knew the companion of Sirius had a mass which is more or less the same as the mass of Sirius, which is one solar mass. Therefore, he asked of his theory, what should be the radius of a star that I have constructed with a mass equal to one solar mass? And he got 10 to the power 4 kilometers. And what was the radius that Walter Adams measured? 10 to the power 4 kilometers. So when Chandrasekhar constructed this theory, believe it or not, there were only 3 known white dwarfs in our galaxy. And for all of them, his mass-radius relation gave very excellent results for the radius and mass. Okay, so this was Chandrasekhar's theory of white dwarf. What he did was immediately write it up and had the audacity to send it to Fowler in Cambridge and then also tried to think about it some more. What are the main conclusion of Chandrasekhar? The main conclusion of Chandrasekhar is that for no matter what the mass of a star is, x-axis, there will be a radius at which it will find equilibrium due to the pressure of the electron gas. Therefore, the important conclusion is stars of all mass will find their ultimate peace as quantum stars supported by the pressure of electrons. These stars need not worry. Nothing can or will ever happen to them because they are now supported by zero point energy and that can never decrease. Okay, fine. Now, today, with the Hubble telescope, if you look at a very small area in a globular cluster, you find these are all white dwarfs. These are all white dwarfs. Every single one of them is white dwarf. So, our understanding is, as I said in my lecture on what are the stars, stars up to about 9 solar mass stop their stellar drama when they convert hydrogen to helium to carbon, and the story ends there because it never gets hot enough for carbon to fuse to form oxygen and go beyond. Therefore, all these things become white dwarfs whose chemical composition is carbon. These white dwarfs are awfully hot. Their temperatures are hundreds of thousands of degrees. But they are dead objects. They simply radiate according to the law 4 pi r squared sigma t to the power 4. And they now have positive specific heat. As they radiate, they will cool and cool and cool. And after billions of years, their temperature will come down to a few thousand degrees when they will crystallize. And then solid-state physicists have wondered a lot and calculated a lot about what crystal structure it will have. As you know, carbon has many allotropic forms, graphene to Buckminster Fuller to carbon to diamond and so on. It depends on the pressure. And you know that if you compress carbon, it becomes diamond. Solid-state physicists, serious solid-state physicists, have come to the conclusion that when these white dwarfs cool and crystallize, they will become diamonds. And each diamond is billions and billions of carats, because you're talking of 10 to the power 33 grams of diamond. And how do you know it is a cross solid? How do you know it has a crystal structure? By seismology. People have studied vibrations of white dwarfs, and just as in the case of the Earth, you can then use, like we did for the sun in the neutrino problem, you can use seismology to probe the interior, and people have come to the conclusion these are in fact solid white dwarfs. Okay? So, you have billions of diamonds in the sky. All right. The following year, Chandrasekhar completed his BSc, and he got a scholarship to go to Cambridge to study with Fowler. So he went to Bombay those days. There was no ship sailing from Madras. And he set sail from Bombay to Cambridge. And during the voyage, he made a very remarkable discovery. And this discovery is at the base of the present revolution in astronomy. And that's what we will now discuss. And this discovery is the gravitational collapse of massive white dwarfs. Now, Chandrasekhar began to think again about what he had done in Madras. He had calculated the mass-radius relationship, which also told him that the central density of a white dwarf will be 6 times the average density, and the average density is proportional to the square of the mass. Therefore, as I go to more and more massive white dwarfs, the density will increase as the square of the mass. And this bothered him a little bit. Because he said, look, have I done everything correctly? But as far as mathematics is concerned, he had done everything absolutely correctly. But he was worried, have I got all the physics correct? And he had the following doubt. Please remember that as I compress a gas and its density increases, the Fermi momentum increases its density to the power 1/3. As we go to more and more massive white dwarfs, as the density increases, the Fermi momentum will increase. At some stage, the momentum will become comparable to m times c. And at that stage, special relativity becomes important. And Newton's mechanics can no longer be used to relate energy and momentum. We had assumed E is p squared divided by 2m. You can't do that because you have to now take into account the variation of mass with velocity. Well, having identified this problem, Chandrasekhar knew exactly what to do with it. Before that, let us discuss what will be the properties of a relativistic Fermi gas. We follow the same steps as before, only one step we don't use, namely E is p squared by 2m. But then Einstein taught us what is the relation between energy and momentum in 1905. We just have to use that, that's all. So let's see, first thing to notice is that the Fermi momentum does not depend on the mass of the particle. Therefore, this formula for the Fermi momentum applies even for a relativistic electron, because this formula merely captures Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and the discreteness of phase space arising out of that. But we can't use that formula anymore. In relativity, the relation between energy and momentum is E squared is m0 squared c to the power 4, where m0 is the rest mass of the particle, plus p squared c squared. If you are dealing with ultra-relativistic particles, in other words, their kinetic energy is very large compared to the rest mass energy, then the first term can be neglected. And then the energy of the particle is of the order of p times c. Is that what it is for light? The momentum of a photon is h nu by c. Therefore, the energy of the photon is E is equal to h nu. So we know this is the correct expression. Now, I'm sure all of you have studied some special relativity. Therefore, I will not drag you through this. But very quickly, I'll flash the slide. This is the relation between the rest mass and the mass of a particle with a velocity v. This is the relativistic expression for the momentum of the particle. That is the expression for the kinetic energy of the particle, which is mc squared minus m0 c squared. Finally, you will get that the square of the energy of the particle is equal to m0 squared c to the power 4 plus p squared c squared. Please do the following simple exercise after the lecture. Convince yourself that this expression in the limit c going to infinity reduces to Newton's law, namely E is equal to p squared by 2m. Okay? Because any correct expression in special relativity must get the Newtonian limit correctly. So try to work it out. E is half mv squared or p squared by 2m should come out of this formula. I leave that as a simple exercise for you. Therefore, we have convinced ourselves the Fermi energy of the particle is not p squared by 2m, but it's just pf times c. And since the Fermi momentum is density to the power 1/3, the Fermi energy remains density to the power 1/3. It does not become density to the power 2/3, as it did in Newtonian mechanics. Now, please remember that in this extreme relativistic case, the Fermi energy does not involve the mass of the particle. Previously, the mass of the particle came in the denominator. That is the meaning of saying you are in extreme relativistic regime. The kinetic energy of the particle far exceeds the rest mass energy, so you can ignore. In the world we live in, rest mass energy far exceeds kinetic energy. Okay? Therefore, now let's calculate the degeneracy pressure of the ultra-relativistic gas. Let me first do a poor man's derivation on the board, and then I will write for you the full formula there. We'll do exactly what we did in the case of non-relativistic gas. We want to calculate the internal energy. The internal energy is the number of particles multiplied by the average energy. Dot, 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 number of particles. Average energy is once again of the order of the Fermi energy. The Fermi energy is density to the power 1 by 3, not 2 by 3. Therefore, the pressure, which is the internal energy divided by volume, 2/3 and all that, is n by v into n to the power 1 by 3, which is of the order of n to the power 4 by 3. So the pressure of a relativistic electron gas will be proportional to the 4/3 power of density and not 5/3 power of density. Now, I've been glib about this. Let's take 3/5 equal to 1 and so on. But for a star, as we will now see, it's a matter of life or death, whether it is 5/3 or 4/3, okay? So let us see very quickly. Those of you who have studied some statistical physics will appreciate this. So if you're Donald Trump owning a big apartment building in Manhattan, the total rent you collect will be the rent from each flat multiplied, which of course will depend on which floor you are. Higher you go, the view is better, the rent is more, multiplied by the probability that the flat is occupied, multiplied by the number of flats in that floor. Okay? That is the same thing you do to calculate the energy of total energy of an electron gas. The integral is from 0 to infinity, but at absolute zero of temperature, the integral can be cut off at the Fermi energy, because this distribution function, this probability, is 1 up to the Fermi energy and 0 above the Fermi energy. Now, what is the density of states? The density of momentum states is 4 pi p squared dp. 4 pi p squared dp is the volume of the shell between a sphere of radius p and p plus dp. That is the volume in phase space, but that is discrete, so you have to divide by the volume of the Lego block, which is h cubed divided by the volume, which becomes volume divided by h cubed. And since I put 2 electrons in each Lego block, 4 pi becomes 8 pi. So the number of momentum states between p and p plus dp in quantum statistics is this. In Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, it is 4 pi, and there is no h in the formula. Now, this can be written in terms of energy by simply changing variables. And if you do that, you find the total energy is equal to EF to the power 4 with some constants in front. The Fermi energy is density to the power 1 by 3. Therefore, the total energy is proportional to density to the power 4 by 3. And therefore, the pressure is the total energy by volume. Some of you should have screamed at this point, because I twice used the relation that the pressure is 2 by 3 times internal energy per unit volume. Suddenly, I've made 2 by 3 into 1 by 3. Okay? Either you know it, or I don't have the time to go into that, but I'll merely state it. I was careful enough to state that the relation between pressure and internal energy is for a gas of particles with finite mass. So if you're dealing with particles which have zero mass or moving very nearly at the speed of light, that 2 by 3 becomes 1 by 3. Okay? So if you want to know this in more detail, it is worth knowing. It is because of this Stefan's law, the radiation pressure is 1 by 3 AT to the power 4. It is not 2 by 3 A to the power 4, okay? And please consult a standard book like Landau and Lipschitz or Zeldovich and Novikov, which is an excellent book to read, friendly book. You will see why you have to use 1 by 3, okay? So for any relativistic particle, ultra-relativistic particles, which you can treat almost having zero mass, neutrinos, for example, then the pressure density. So this gives us the density is proportional to this. Okay, let me not belabor the point. Chandrasekhar, in his theory constructed in Madras, had used in the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium for the degeneracy pressure, which is proportional to density to the power 5 by 3. Now on the boat going to Madras, to Cambridge, he derived an expression for the relativistic electron gas, which is proportional to the 4/3 power of density. So there in all its glory with all the constants are the expressions for the non-relativistic gas and relativistic gas. Please notice the mass of the particle comes in the non-relativistic pressure. The mass of the particle does not enter the relativistic pressure. So it is the same for a neutron gas as an electron gas. So please do work out these constants, because physics is all about getting your pi's and numbers correctly, okay? So please work it out. This is why I said in the first lecture, leave the left-hand side of your notebook blank, so that you can now go and redo these derivations. Okay, so what Chandrasekhar did was, instead of integrating the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, with the pressure density relation given for the non-relativistic gas, which gave this mass radius relation, what you do is integrate this equation of hydrostatic equilibrium with the expression E is equal to PC, which gave rise to a pressure relativistic pressure, which is proportional to density to the power 4 by 3. Okay? And when he did this, the bottom fell out. Because what he found was a fully relativistic white dwarf has no radius. It has a mass, but no radius. You see that mistake that I made there? Suppose it was not a mistake. Then you'll find this would be r to the power 5. There is r to the power 5 here. And I've erased this r to the power 5 in the other side. Radius drops out. So let's do this. This is, after all, he got a Nobel Prize for this formula. So let's do a scaling argument again. P by, left-hand side is P by R, equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. Pressure is density to the power 4 by 3. And then there is P by R in equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. That is of the order M, G, M, rho, which is m by r cubed by r squared, gm rho over r squared. Now again, so this thing is m to the power 4 by 3 divided by r to the power 5. And here I have m to the power 2 divided by r to the power 5. Therefore, you see the radius drops out. But you can solve this equation for the mass. And when you solve the equation for the mass, what you get is one of the most remarkable formulae in all of physics. This is known as the Chandrasekhar limiting mass. It is the same combination of fundamental constant we constructed when we asked the question, why are the stars as they are in Eddington's theory? So we constructed a combination of fundamental constants that came from the stellar equation of stellar structure, which is hc by g to the power 3 halves, 1 over the square of the mass of the proton, and 1 over the mean molecular weight mu e. That time, it was of the order of this, and that gave us a value of 29.2 solar mass. This time, it's an exact result. It's a mathematically exact result. This 0.197 is really some pi to the power 4 divided by 916, which comes from some Riemann zeta function integral, okay? So this is an exact result. So as I said that day, this is the cube of the Planck mass, this is the square of the proton mass. Therefore, the Chandrasekhar limiting mass is the cube of the Planck mass divided by the square of the proton mass. What is this mean molecular weight? Horrible phrase, right? Mean molecular weight. Well, it's very simple. Please notice that whenever I have derived an expression for the pressure or the Fermi energy or the Fermi momentum, I have done it in terms of the number density of particles, n to the power 1 by 3, n to the power 5 by 3, n to the power 4 by 3. But in an equation of hydrostatic equilibrium, I want mass, I don't want number. So I want to convert this number density to mass density. How do I do that? I multiply and divide by the mass of the particle. Do I multiply by the mass of the electron? No. Although the pressure is supplied by the electrons, and the protons and neutrons are passive spectators, as far as gravity is concerned, they only talk to neutrons and protons. So you say, okay, no, instead of the mass of the electron, put the mass of the proton. Is that correct? For each electron, is there only one proton? No, it's not true. For hydrogen, for each electron, there is only one proton. But for helium, for two electrons, there are four particles in the nucleus. And for the rest of the periodic table, Z over A is half for the entire periodic table except for hydrogen, right? Therefore, this mean molecular weight has the physical meaning that mu E times the mass of the proton is the mass per electron. Okay? So when I convert the number density to mass density rho, I multiplied and divide not by, I have to take this into account. So that is the mean molecular weight that enters into the formula. Therefore, if our star is made of anything except hydrogen, I don't care if it's helium or carbon or oxygen or silicon or iron, mu E is 2. Therefore, this Chandrasekhar limiting mass has a numerical value of approximately 1.4 times the mass of the sun stated in that unit. But please remember, this is an exact result. What to make of this result? Well, Chandrasekhar didn't know what the hell does it mean to say a star has a unique mass but no radius. Remember our physicists in a cloud-bound planet who constructed stars. And then they found that it is a spectrum of masses. But if our physicists, that during the next monsoon, constructed stars in which gravity is balanced by the quantum mechanical pressure of the electron and the electron gas is relativistic, they will find the star has no radius. What does it mean? He didn't know. So when he reached Cambridge, he gave this paper to Fowler. He didn't know. He sent it to some very distinguished theoretical physicists. They didn't know. So what Chandrasekhar did was somewhat sneaky. You know, you don't publish a paper till you really know what the hell it means, right? And since he knew that all these great British physicists didn't understand what this result meant, including himself, he sneakily sent this paper to an American journal, the Astrophysical Journal, and published it, okay? And a good thing too, he did. But then, then he got busy with his thesis, which was really on something else, stellar atmospheres. He came back to this problem. He said, look, in Madras, I made the assumption that the electrons obey Newton's law. On the boat, I said electrons are ultra-relativistic. But why do I have to make this assumption? E squared is p squared c squared plus m0 squared c to the power 4. Let me use this full expression and integrate. There is no argument about this, right? Well, not that simple. There were no computers. There weren't even electric calculators. There was just log tables. And it took him almost a year to integrate this differential equation with the exact equation of state. And when he did that in 1933, this is the result he found. Once again, radius versus mass. The theory he had constructed in Madras with E is equal to P squared by 2m gave this result. The exact theory with an exact equation of state agreed with the approximate theory for low mass, because for low mass, the density is low, the electrons are non-relativistic, and therefore that theory is rigorously valid. But for more massive mass, the exact theory deviated, and around one solar mass, it nosedived, and the radius went to zero at the limiting mass of 1.4 solar mass. Now, that's the mass. Stars more massive than 1.4 solar mass cannot be supported by the pressure of the electron. That is the meaning of this discovery. They will collapse. Please remember that when Chandrasekhar made this discovery, there were only two known elementary particles, the electron and the proton. The neutron had not yet been discovered. Okay? Now, this extraordinary discovery revolutionized our view of the heavens, although it took almost 45 years to appreciate the full significance of this discovery. Between 1930 and 1972, Chandrasekhar had become one of the most distinguished persons in science, and he received every award that was to be given, but not one award mentioned his work on white dwarfs, because people weren't sure. It is only with the discovery of the neutron star in 1968, the full significance of all these things dawned on people. Therefore, the first time that his work on white dwarf was mentioned was when he received the American Physical Society Heinemann Prize in 1972. Till then, nobody mentioned all these things. Okay, but today we know that this extraordinary discovery is truly revolutionary. This signaled gravitational collapse of stars. Soon this led, as we will see in the next lecture, this led to the notion of neutron stars, supernova explosions, and black holes. Now this great discovery marked the beginning of the era of high energy astrophysics, which is today. This is the era of neutron stars, supernova, and black hole. But more profoundly, it marked the end of the Aristotelian view of the universe. Here is Aristotle, 384 BC to 322, admittedly one of the greatest thinkers. According to Aristotle's view, which prevailed for 2,000 years, the matter of which the heavens are made is imperishable, and thus not subject to generation or corruption. Nothing can happen to them. In contrast, the earth is made up of the classical elements and is perishable. The motion in the heavens are eternal and perfect. The heavens are the realms of peace and perfection. Okay? Now this was the Aristotelian view which prevailed for 2,000 years. Indeed, the serenity and the permanence of the night sky was a source of awe and security for mankind from time immemorial. Nothing changes in the heavens. Suddenly this kid comes along and says, stars will implode, collapse, if their mass exceeds one certain critical mass. Now, how was this result received? In 1935, there was an important meeting of the Royal Astronomical Society in London, where Chandrasekhar was invited to present his result. And Eddington was presiding over that meeting. In fact, they went by train together from Cambridge to London. But Eddington didn't tell him what he was going to speak. Now, after Chandrasekhar finished his talk, in which he expounded on his theory, Eddington got up and made a speech which is historic. As part of the speech, he said, "I do not know whether I shall escape from this meeting alive, but the point of my paper is that there is no such thing as relativistic degeneracy." Chandrasekhar, using the relativistic formula which has been accepted for the last 5 years, shows that a star of mass greater than a certain limit M remains a perfect gas and can never cool down. I have not discussed this with you yet. I will discuss this on Friday. This is perhaps the most profound discovery Chandrasekhar made in his life. Unfortunately, this is neither read nor quoted nor appreciated. So I want you to appreciate that Eddington picked on this paper about which I have not told you. Let's continue with Eddington. So Eddington was not upset with this limiting mass. Eddington was very upset with Chandrasekhar saying that above a critical mass M, the gas will not become degenerate. It will remain a perfect gas, and therefore the collapse is inevitable. The star has to go on radiating and radiating and contracting until, I suppose, it gets down to a few kilometer radius when gravity becomes strong enough to hold in the radiation and the star can at last find peace. Otherwise, it'll become a black hole. Dr. Chandrasekhar had got this result before, but he has rubbed it in his last paper. That is this paper. And when discussing with him, I felt driven to the conclusion that this was almost a reductio ad absurdum of the relativistic degeneracy formula. Various accidents may intervene to save the star, but I want more protection than that. I think there should be a law of nature to prevent a star from behaving in this absurd way. So you can imagine what a blow it was to Chandrasekhar. A very young man, 24 years old at the time, and being put down by the most famous astronomer in the world. He couldn't do anything because to the astronomical community, Eddington was the high priest. So he appealed to physicists. In 1932, when he was a student still, he had spent a year at Niels Bohr's Institute in Copenhagen. And there he had cultivated the gang of young kids who were surrounding Bohr at the time, Landau, Gamow, Rosenfeld, Pauli, they were all there in Bohr's Institute. Bohr was the godfather for all of them. So he appealed to them and said, "Look, what do you guys think? Show it to Professor Bohr." So he sent his papers to Rosenfeld, a most distinguished student of Niels Bohr, and said, "Please make Niels Bohr read this paper, and I want to know what he thinks." And these were all postcards. I mean, it's so wonderful these days, with all this email, we forget those days people actually wrote postcards, and next week a postcard will come from Copenhagen, he will reply to that, and a few days later another postcard will come. And here is the sort of reaction that he got from Copenhagen. Leon Rosenfeld wrote, "Bohr and I are absolutely unable to see any meaning in Eddington's statements. It seems to us that Eddington's statement that several high-speed electrons might be in one cell in phase space," in other words, Eddington rejected the notion of Pauli's exclusion principle for relativistic gas. You can put any number of particles, why only two? So let me read. "It seems to us that Eddington's statement that several high-speed electrons might be in one cell in phase space would imply that to another observer, several slow-speed electrons, in contrast to Pauli's principle, would be in the same cell." In other words, special relativity, right? So what appears very fast particle will appear to you as a slow particle, and you put five slow particles in a cell in phase space. So Eddington, could you perhaps induce Eddington to state his views in terms intelligible to humble mortals? Pauli's reaction was typical. Eddington doesn't understand physics. But this is not a very fair statement, as we will see in the next lecture and in some other lectures. There's a lot written about, here is this brown-skinned Indian in Imperial England, racism and so on, nothing of the type. Eddington and Chandrasekhar remained the greatest of friends. And when Eddington died in 1944, Chandrasekhar organized a memorial in the Rockefeller Chapel at the University of Chicago. For Eddington centennial, Cambridge invited Chandrasekhar to give the centenary lecture. So what is it that bothered Eddington? Obviously, he's bothered by something which nobody had even spotted yet. Okay, so we will see that in the later lectures. So please reserve, it is so easy to condemn Eddington, but there is another way to look at Eddington. He saw things far ahead of others. And we will see, 1965, a theorem by Roger Penrose. In 1934, Eddington had already anticipated all that. Okay. So reserve judgment on this. Let us end today's lecture by recalling what Chandrasekhar actually said at the end of these two epoch-making papers. In the paper about which I have not told you yet, which I will on Friday, in 1932, Chandrasekhar, the last sentences, for all stars of mass greater than M, the perfect gas equation of state does not break down, however high the density may become, and the matter does not become degenerate. An appeal to the Fermi-Dirac statistics to avoid the central singularity cannot be made. He's not saying it'll become a white dwarf and that white dwarf will become unstable. He says it cannot become a white dwarf because Boyle's law never breaks down. Great progress in the analysis of stellar structure is not possible before we can answer the following fundamental question. Given an enclosure containing electrons and atomic nuclei of total charge zero, what happens if we go on compressing the material indefinitely? That was 1932. And that question was answered by Landau only in 1937. Okay. This is what upset Eddington very much. The ideal gas law will never break down. The star will have to contract and contract and contract till it becomes a black hole. Okay, the 1934 paper of the limiting mass of white dwarfs, the last sentences. Finally, it is necessary to emphasize one major result of the whole investigation, namely, that it must be taken as well established that the life history of a star of small mass must be essentially different from the life history of a star of large mass. For a star of small mass, the natural white dwarf stage is an initial step towards complete extinction. A star of large mass cannot pass into the white dwarf stage, and one is left speculating on other possibilities. So the other possibilities is what we will discuss on Friday, and later on when we discuss black holes. So we'll end this lecture on that note, and I'll be happy if you have any questions. Thank you. Please do fill in all those things in front of the proportionality. Yes, go ahead.
Hello. Hello. So my question is, when we balance the gravitational pressure against the degeneracy pressure, we assumed it to be at t equal to zero. And that gave us the limiting mass to be 1.4 solar mass in the relativistic case. So if we take into account really hot white dwarfs, which have just passed into white dwarf stage from the normal star stage. In that case, since the thermal pressure will also be in play, can a very hot white dwarf stay at a mass greater than 1.4 solar mass? Because then the thermal pressure will also be helping the degeneracy pressure to hold the gravity.
The answer is no, and I'll tell you why. It's a very good question, but the answer is... Can you all see what I write on the board? You can read from the back? Okay. All right. Let me answer this question in several ways. Let us plot the probability function f of e as a function of energy. This is the probability that an energy level e is occupied. According to Fermi-Dirac statistics, at absolute zero, that probability is 1 and 0. So that is 1, that is 0, and that energy is the Fermi energy. This is the story at t equal to 0. Now let us ask, what happens at a finite temperature, which is your question? What happens is that at a finite temperature, this distribution function remains the same, but just over here, it develops a very small tail. In other words, electrons from there are upgraded to above the Fermi level. Now, why is this a small effect? It is a small effect because all states up to the Fermi energy were occupied, and this energy is what we called as the Fermi energy. One of the conditions for abandoning classical statistics in favor of quantum statistics is that this Fermi energy is very large compared to the thermal energy KT. Okay? Therefore, if I heat this energy bucket, only little ripples can be created because KT, you can only dig out a particle, so this width is of the order of KT, okay? Therefore, I can now ask, I have calculated the pressure of an electron gas at absolute zero of temperature, which is your question. How is it related to the pressure at a finite temperature? Well, that will be the pressure at zero temperature. These electrons that have been pushed above the Fermi level, they have heat energy, which is what your question is, and they will contribute to the pressure. So if you now work out, you will find a term which is of the order of KT divided by EF whole squared, if I'm not mistaken, plus higher order terms. Now, KT is very small compared to EF. If you look in Kittel's solid state physics book or some book like this, you will see all these formulae written down or Landau-Lipschitz to discuss. So the answer to your question is, if you take electrons in metal, copper or sodium, the Fermi energy is of the order of a few electron volts. I said that day that one electron volt is equivalent to 10 to the power 4 Kelvin. In other words, 10 to the power 4 Kelvin multiplied by Boltzmann's constant is equal to 1 electron volt. Therefore, the Fermi energy of electrons in metals at terrestrial densities is several electron volts, which is several times 10 to the power 4 Kelvin, which is a large number compared to 300 Kelvin, which is the temperature of the metal. So already in a metal, the Fermi energy is very large compared to KT, which is why Sommerfeld abandoned classical statistics and used Fermi-Dirac statistics to explain the specific heat of metals. So when you go from a density of few grams per cubic centimeter to a million grams per cubic centimeter of a white dwarf, EF increases so enormously that, and that by the time you go to a neutron star, as we'll see, at a density of 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter, even a temperature of 10 to the 8 Kelvin is like liquid helium temperatures compared to EF. Okay? So that is how we'll argue neutron stars should be superconductors and superfluids, even though their temperature is 100 million degrees. 100 million degrees is zero compared to EF. Does that answer your question? But please work out this formula for the finite temperature. You'll find it written in all the books, okay? Yeah. The answer is in principle, yes, but you have to work out how much. His question, if you can't hear, if a white dwarf is rotating, then there is help from centrifugal force also. You can ask, how fast should a white dwarf rotate? Work it out, please, all of you. You know how to work out the centrifugal energy of a sphere of mass m and radius r, and ask at what speed of rotation will centrifugal force be of any help to you. Isn't it? Centrifugal force should increase the limiting mass. So you have to worry about whether you have to spin it so fast that the white dwarf becomes unstable due to rotation. You have to ask, is that possible? Okay. Again, we'll see. I don't know, but it's a very important question. Magnetic field, similarly, B squared over 8 pi is the energy density of the magnetic field per unit volume. You can work it out. Take a magnetic field of white dwarf of a million Gauss and see if it is dynamically significant. Do the same thing for neutron stars after I tell you next on Friday or next week. What are the magnetic fields of neutron stars and so on. So the same question you can ask for neutron stars also, okay? So the answer to your question in one sentence is yes, rotation, magnetic field, all these things in principle will help in supporting you against gravity. But the question is, what should the rotation rate be? What should the magnetic field be before they become dynamically significant? And you'll find that they are not very dynamically significant. But you have to convince yourself so by putting numbers. I didn't say radius is zero. This thing simply says radius drops out, has no radius. To conclude that radius goes to zero required a full calculation. You calculate the full sequence, and there you see the radius going to zero as you approach this limiting mass, okay? That simply gave a mysterious result. It gave a mass, it gave no radius. So one didn't know what it meant. You understand? One didn't know what it meant. One doesn't know. It remained a mystery for 3 years or 4 years till the full equation was solved. Okay? It was a surprising result. How can a relativistic star not have a radius? That mystery was solved only by solving the full equation that showed that as the star becomes more and more relativistic, the radius becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, till finally when it becomes fully relativistic, the radius tends to zero. No, first of all, don't confuse between what Eddington said. Eddington's way of stating things is very confusing. All he meant to say, as Fowler explained, in the language of ordinary mortals, is the following. You take any piece of matter, a unit volume of matter. It has certain kinetic energy, and it has a certain potential energy, electrostatic potential energy, electron, 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 proton, 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 right? So it has a total energy. What is the condition that this can expand? The kinetic energy per unit volume should be larger than the attractive potential energy per unit volume. The kinetic energy depends on the density as well as temperature in classical physics, right? The potential energy depends only on density, mean particle spacing, Coulomb's law, right? So what Fowler said was, look, friends, this is what Eddington meant. If you ask the condition, the kinetic energy should be greater than the potential energy. You have on the left-hand side some combination of density and temperature. Right-hand side, you have only density, Coulomb energy. Then you can ask, can this inequality ever be violated? It is violated when you go to densities of the order of million grams per cubic centimeter, temperatures of the order of 100,000 degrees. This was Eddington's problem. His problem is, if I scoop out a piece of matter from this companion of Sirius, take it out, it is no longer subjected to gravitational pressure. It should expand to the normal matter density. But in order to expand to the normal matter density, the kinetic energy should be greater than the potential energy. But it is not. That was his worry. What Fowler said was, the mistake you made was in calculating kinetic energy using classical statistics. If you use quantum statistics to calculate kinetic energy, which is the Fermi energy or some fraction of it, you will find this thing will be able to expand. You understand? With regard to the diamond structure, I think you got this thing confused there. The point is, there you're talking about this carbon, which is crystallized because the temperature is low. Please remember, the melting temperature of matter depends both on density and temperature, right? And you're at extremely high density. Then you have to ask, what crystal configuration is the lowest energy? So what physicists would call as a phase diagram, thermodynamic phase diagram. Now what we find is, how do you make diamond? By compressing carbon, isn't it? Either nature does it for you, or you form an anvil in which you squeeze matter, and then it reaches a diamond structure, right? That's how artificial diamonds are made. So what I'm saying is, people have calculated this thermodynamics, the phase diagram of this carbon at this extreme density, and they have convinced themselves that the lowest free energy configuration is a diamond structure. Okay. I don't think the last word is, for all you know, it may be graphene or Buckminster Fuller or something like this, because nobody has encountered this kind of densities in a laboratory experiment. So the question arises, to what extent you can extend the phase diagram from your handbook of physics to those densities. Yes?
You said that in the ultra-relativistic case, the radius goes to zero. So if that happens, then all the particles will go to one state, right?
No.
So what does it mean that to say that radius goes to zero?
Huh?
What does it mean to say that the radius tends to zero?
I mean exactly that.
So, I mean, then
particles don't go into the same state. As the radius becomes smaller and smaller, the density increases. Therefore, the Fermi momentum goes on increasing. So you never violate Pauli's principle or anything like that. This is a mistake. Lot of my physics friends say, oh, Chandrasekhar's result, it can't be right. You violate Pauli's principle. You never violate Pauli's principle. You understand? It's just that the radius becomes smaller and smaller. It becomes a quantum object. The question is, will it eventually stop or will it collapse to a singularity? And once it collapses to a singularity, you stop worrying about Pauli's principle and all that, because you enter an era of unknowns. This is just one more unknown. Okay? Are there any... Yes? You have to have... Yeah. No, there's one here. Just pass it. Oh, not working. Okay. All right. You don't put it in anywhere at all. Those fundamental forces are between two particles. Yes. This is a force that arises when you try to go to a many-particle system. So this is the force that arises in statistical distribution of matter. Okay. So this should not be confused in any way with those fundamental forces. This is a consequence. This is a consequence, okay? So for example, I take a gas and I compress the gas. The atomic shells of two molecules begin to repel each other. And there is a force. This is called van der Waals force. This has nothing to do with fundamental forces. The fundamental forces is the electrostatic forces. So this arises because you are squeezing atomic shells close to one another. Okay, so this is an apparent repulsion that arises due to Pauli's principle. That is Pauli's principle, right? So having stated that, the matter ends there. For two particles, he said you can only put one particle in each quantum state. You can't put two. Only one particle in each quantum state, because this spin and this spin are different quantum states. The two particles have the same momentum, same position, same energy, but their spin angular momentum is different. So Pauli's principle says you can only put one particle in each quantum state, so the problem doesn't arise. Is that clear? Okay. Yes.
When the white dwarfs shine for a very long time, does the brightness show some periodic variation, or does it decrease more quickly?
When a white dwarf radiates, the white dwarf is just like a piece of hot, is it like a hot plate in your kitchen or a piece of hot charcoal. As it radiates, it'll get cooler, and then it'll radiate less, and therefore cooling down rate is decreasing, right? But for entirely different reason, a few meters on the surface of the white dwarf, there is an atmosphere. That atmosphere still has atoms. And you can see that spectroscopically. So in other words, if you send the light from a white dwarf through a slit in a prism or a grating, you see spectral lines. Where are these coming from? Well, it is just a thin atmosphere. You understand? And that atmosphere sometimes pulsates because of some very fancy physics, that's the instability that occurs. Therefore, since the luminosity that we see is sigma t to the power 4 multiplied by 4 pi r squared, as the radius of the outer radius of the white dwarf changes with time periodically, the light of the white dwarf will oscillate periodically. Okay? And that is seismology. It need not be a single mode. There can be a whole lot of modes. For example, Dr. Sita, at the ISRO headquarters, she is the director of the program, Space Science Program Office. She did her PhD thesis on white dwarf oscillations. So it is helio seismology. Here it is astro seismology. So you can invert these oscillations, Fourier analyze them, and try to deduce properties of the interior. So that's not the same thing as the entire white dwarf oscillating. It's only the outer atmosphere that is puffing up and down. I hope that answers the question. Okay, if there are no further questions, on Friday, we will discuss what happens to this, what one is left speculating on other possibilities. We will see how that unfolded. And that will take us to neutron stars. Thank you.